So I have exactly 7 minutes to explain what research software is all about and why it's important. And Joris asked me about this last week, if I could do this, and I thought, okay, how can I explain this best? And I thought maybe it's just best to give a couple of inspirational examples, or at least examples that are inspirational to me. And it's actually quite hard to do it in such a short time, because software is so diverse, and research software specifically is very diverse. So I came up with a very simple classification, just for to make it clear, basically. So sometimes research software is a component of a scientific instrument. But in some cases, software actually is the instrument. And I'll come back to this in a minute, actually. In some cases, software is there to analyze your research data. Sometimes it's basically to present the results of your research. And in some cases, equally important, I think, and that's what Carol also just talked about, software is super glue, duct tape, and lubricant for research. So I'll basically give examples for each of those classes. So the first one, software is a crucial part of our scientific instruments. I think today it's basically completely unfeasible to build a modern scientific instrument without software, right? If you're building a telescope, a radio telescope in this case, you receive a signal from the sky and you have to turn this into an image. You have to put the or change the raw bits and bytes, process them sometimes in real time, very complex algorithms, and you make an image out of this. And that's then suitable to do your research with. Very similar also with electron microscopes up there and maybe with an MRI scanner. In all those cases, there's lots of software under the hood actually processing the raw data, turning it into information. So you cannot build or operate an instrument anymore these days without research software. Even if you want to design an instrument, you actually typically do that in software. You build prototypes and models of the instruments before you actually build them, because it's very expensive to build them. In other cases, software actually is the instrument. What I'm talking about then is computational modeling. And this is a nice picture of an ocean model. And many people worked on this. It's really a collaborative project with many researchers and research software engineers at the eScience Center. So this is an ocean model showing all sorts of turbulence and eddies in the oceans. And you can say something about the sea level, which of course is very important if you live in the Netherlands. Actually, a fun fact, my own house is actually below the sea level. So this is why I find this really quite interesting. Otherwise, I would get wet feet. So here, this is software. It's a software model. This is another example. It's pretty hard to see, I think. But that's a blood vessel, a computational model of a blood vessel. And basically, the idea is what happens if you put a stent in. What happens with the cell growth if you basically have an intervention. Now, you can also have computational models of other parts of your body. This is a model of your heart, for example. So in all those cases, software actually is the instrument. Another reason to use research software is basically to analyze research data. And it can be data from those models, it can be data from those instruments, it can be data from a survey, it can be really broad, depends on your discipline. Now again, a nice inspirational example. This is ASM Vol tool, and ASM means Earth System Model. So this is basically a tool that we again worked on with many other international partners that basically takes the data from a climate model and makes very nice graphs and plots and pictures out of those climate data models. And those pictures are of course used to share ideas and insights with other researchers, but also for policy making. So those plots actually end up in the IPCC report. You probably have heard about this, the International Panel for Climate Change. So these are the basis of our climate policies. There's a direct link between the software, the models, and the policy. Because you want to have fact-based policies, of course, right? And this is how you get there. Software is also actually used to present the output of our research. And in this case, this is an example from archaeology. This is the Via Appia, which is a very famous road from Rome to Brindisi in Italy. And we basically made a whole digital model of this road and all the monuments along the road. And you can basically walk around in a virtual environment with VR glasses on or just in a web browser. and inspect those monuments. And the researchers then basically recreate the buildings or the monuments that actually used to be there, 2,000 years ago. So they use it to share their own insights between researchers, but it's also a tool for outreach. You can also show this to the general public and explain what we're doing with our research and why it's important. And this is actually used in several museum exhibitions now. So it's a very different goal for research software. Actually, I would still call this research software because it's also used for research, and we use the same software also for outreach. And also because it's very specific to a certain research question, basically. Another thing that I mentioned, software is super glue, duct tape, and lubricant. This is basically what Carol also mentioned, workflow systems. You want to automate very complex workflow processes that you have to do. Sometimes you have to repeat them many, many times. So you want to automate them because it's more efficient, but also because then you have high quality. It's easy to make a mistake as a human. If you just automate it, then if you don't have any bugs in your software, it should not make mistakes. So that's workflows and deployment. There's also integration. There's a lot of effort and time and energy and blood, sweat and tears going into integration of different software packages. And it can be from the level of science or just combining different open source packages, for example, to do your data analysis. But also in models, for example, there are many different models. If you want to make a climate model, you have to model the ocean, the atmosphere, glaciers, volcanoes, and you have to combine all of this together. And it actually takes a lot of work to integrate this. So that's an undertaking in its own. It's not just underwear, I think. It's really important. Even though you might not see it. This is sometimes very far from the researcher, the daily practice of the researcher. Another important thing where you need underwear is research sharing. So this is actually a tool that we built where we let hydrologists share their models. So they share their models, they upload their models to this platform. They can compare the different models with one another, basically to validate them. You can also think about the FAIR principles for data. If you want to implement the FAIR principles, you actually need to build platforms to do this. You need support in software to make this happen. It's not free. It's not only about data. Because you can actually, of course, you can store the data. And there's a lot of discussions about RDM, research data management. But if you don't store the software that's needed to share the data, but also to analyze the data, then the data is just bits on a disk, right? It's basically useless without the software to interpret the data. It's not information yet. So basically to summarize, without software, we cannot build or operate our scientific instruments, our telescopes, our microscopes, things like this. We cannot model climate change, but there are many other examples where you use computational models. It's also in ecology, modeling our ecosystems, biodiversity, our own bodies, virus outbreaks, of course, a very recent example, social interactions, inequality in social sciences. So it's really, really broad. And we need those models to steer our policies, to make sure that our policies are really based on science and on factual data. Now, we cannot process our data, like I said, without software. And also the automation part is really important. So this is sort of the summary of my summary. Software is sometimes very prominent. If it's a computational model, for example. Sometimes it's just a cog in a machine. It's unaware. It's not so visible. Sometimes it's actually completely invisible. It's really under the hood. But it's always really important, even though it's not always visible. Thank you.